right, let's review the roles of the client and server in the Ajax interaction. Then we're going to look at the example we had last time, and we're going to extend it a bit. The client has the following roles. The client is sort of the driving force with Ajax, which makes sense because we're talking about ultimately altering a page that's already been loaded. And that's the job of client-side scripting because that page is loaded in the browser. So if we want to change that page, the initiative has to come from the client. The server's just out there. After the server delivers a page, the server's just out there sitting waiting for the next request. So that page lives within the browser. So if we want to make any changes to it, like in the case of Google, get the next suggested search terms, or in the case of our example, grade the quiz, the client has to initiate. So the client is responsible for the following things. Number one, making the object that serves as the pipeline. Typically, this will happen as soon as the page loads. We're going to make that object right away so that we have it available if we need to make that request. And the manner in which it is created is browser dependent. In other words, depending on the kind of browser, the exact instructions to make that vary a little bit. But once you make that object, the rest of it works the same regardless of the browser that you're using. So the client side is responsible for doing this. The client side then, at the appropriate time, based on some user action, and again, in the case of Google, it could be the user pressing a key. In the case of our quiz, it could be us clicking the button to say, go ahead and grade the quiz. But at some point, a user action initiates a JavaScript function. And that JavaScript function uses the pipeline to make a request to the server. The request to the server is what? It's a URL. That's how requests get sent to the server, via URL. So in other words, you type in something in your address bar. That's making a request to the server. What do you type in your address bar? You type into the address bar a URL. You click on a link. You are making a request. What is the request? Well, the URL that the link is for. You press submit on a form. You are making a request. What is the URL? Well, the action of the form is the URL. And you pass the data associated with that form. So the only difference between this and other requests that the client makes is we're actually writing a function to use that pipeline to make the request. So we actually hand code the request ourselves. Now, part of making the request is we define in the pipeline a callback function. And this is the one piece that is a little different than anything we've done before. The idea of a callback function is this. This happens asynchronously. That means not at the same time. So it's more like exchanging voicemails than having a phone conversation. When you have a phone conversation, that is a synchronous conversation, right? Because you're both on the phone at the same time. You say something, the other person responds, and back and forth. If you're exchanging voicemails, all right, you send your message out to them, you don't know when they're going to respond. So you don't sit there waiting for them to send you a voicemail back, right? You give your number and say, hey, call me at such and such number. When they get around to it, they send a request back and they use that phone number to send the response back to you. Well, the callback function is sort of like your return phone number. It is what is going to get executed when the server is done processing your request. So, when your request is finished, that callback function gets called. And then you can do something with the results. And that's sort of the last thing that the client is responsible for, is doing something with the results from the server. So in the case of Google, as you type in words, it forms a drop-down for you that you can pick the search term. In our case, we put next to the quiz question whether they got it right or wrong. So the client does all of this. The server is responsible for just one thing: processing the request. Doing whatever it needs to do to handle the request. In our case, it looks at the answer, compares it to the correct answer, and returns either correct or incorrect. And it's going to return the data in one of several different forms. Either, well, there are a couple other options, but for the most part, delimited data, JSON data, or XML data. For the first while, we're going to focus on delimited data. And then we'll get into JSON and XML data later on. But that's all the server does. Takes a request, returns the answer. It's no longer responsible for returning a complete page for this part of the operation. For this part of the operation, it's simply returning the response back. All right, so let's look at the example we had last time and see what's going on. And then we'll enhance it a little bit. We'll enhance it to do a couple different things. So I'm going to go and copy these guys over to my web servers folder. have this question. I can click an answer, click calculate, and without reloading the page, it gives me that response back. All right, so let's look at the code that does that. Most of the code is going to be in quiz.html. It's going to be in the HTML side. So let's find each of the pieces that I have up on the board. The first piece, creating the request object. That exists within the script. And notice that this var HTTP is declared outside of any function. That makes it a global variable. When you define a variable in JavaScript outside of any function, that means that it can be used inside of any function. All right? So that makes it a global variable. So that's why this is not within any function. This will execute as soon as the page loads. So as soon as the page loads, we have that object available to do whatever we want to with it. Now, remember we said it is browser dependent. This creates the request object one of two different ways, depending on whether you're on Internet Explorer or not. In either case, it returns the request object, and I store it in a variable called HTTP. So as soon as this page loads, this variable gets set to the results of this create request object, and that create request object creates a request object one of two different ways. Alright, so that HTTP variable contains a request object that's waiting out there to handle Ajax requests. Alright, the user initiates the Ajax action. In our case, they do that by clicking a button to process the form. Processing the form first validates the form, make sure that they've entered everything in. Now, I haven't completed that. I'm lying, and I'm just saying the form is valid no matter what. But if the form is valid, I go and perform get results. Get results is the portion that is going to make the request and give the callback function. So how do we make the request? Well, I format the URL. Remember, we have written, or we are going to write, either both the client side and the server side code. So we know the format that the request needs to be in. And in this case, we know that the format of the request is this. It has to be gradequiz.php answer1 equals, and then either a T or an F. A T if the person checked true, an F if they've checked false. So I'm forming the URL by hard coding this piece of it, because I know that piece is the same no matter what. What's different is the actual value of the answer, whether it's T or an F. And I grab that by looking at which of the radio buttons was selected. So if answer 1 was selected, or rather if true for answer 1 is selected, I set my variable A1 to T. If the false button was selected, I set it to an F. And then I add that as part of the URL. So this is the request that I'm going to make. Now remember, when we make the request, when we send our voicemail, we have to give the number that's our callback number. In other words, where we need to be notified when the request has been completed, when there's a response. And in our case, that is the name of the function that's going to handle the response. And in our case, the name of the function that's going to handle the response is called displayResults. And here we actually make the request. We actually send that data to the server and let the server do its thing. All right. So at this point, we've made the request. And the client, frankly, for the microseconds that it takes for the server to respond, is just sitting there waiting for the response back. Now, the server code that handles this is very straightforward. We simply look at the value of the answer. If it's equal to F, then they got the answer correct, and we echo correct. If it's not F, we echo the value of incorrect. That's all that the server does. The server simply returns one word. In fact, actually, shouldn't even return that HTML. Should just literally return correct or incorrect. Shouldn't even return, because it doesn't need to return those HTML tags, because it's not returning a complete web page. It's just returning the words correct or the words incorrect. So, when the server has sent its response back, the display result function gets called. How do we know it gets called? Because that's the function that we set on our pipeline for on ready state change. Now, it doesn't only get called when the request is done. It gets called at a couple steps throughout the process. The ready state says at what step the server is at. A ready state of 4 means that the server is done. So we are then able to get the value of the results and display those on the page. Now, if we're using delimited data, which we're sort of using here, or we're using JSON, the response is going to come back in a variable in the pipeline called response text. So HTTP response text is where the server puts the result. So in our case, what I do is I get the value of that response text, and then I display it in my results in our HTML. So there's my results. It says whether they got that question correct or incorrect. And I could put that anywhere. So I could put that before the question if I wanted to. And it's going to work the same way. Puts it there. Okay. So, in this case, I'm simply displaying whether they got it correct or incorrect. Alright? I could actually make it simpler and just return a Y or an N if I wanted to. Y indicating they got it correct and N indicating that they got it incorrect. Say I don't want to display a Y or an N, I want to do something else. Well, that's the client's job. The server simply returns back data. It's the client's responsibility to format that data any way we want to. So, for example, we could display an image. Why I'm looking at this like this is the most important decision I'm going to make today. It's what smiley face to pick. Let's pick this one. Let's pick the thumbs up one. All right? We could display a happy face if they got it right, and then a frowny face if they got it wrong. Oh, that looks harsh. Mm-hmm. That's a little harsh for me, but I'm going to use it anyhow. Yeah, really? Yeah. And then I'm gonna edit these real quick to make them smaller, because, I mean, we're not that happy, nor are we that sad. So, let's go here. Let's make that 10%. That's a little too small. Let's make it 20%. Perfect. I'll change this to say, I'll change the names of them simply to be right and wrong. Okay. So I'm going to copy those in here. And I'm going to change my quiz. Have it open. And I'm going to make this a little more involved. Instead of simply outputting what the server gave me, remember the server gave me a Y or an N, I'm going to test that value. And if that value equals Y, I'm going to display the right. And if it's wrong, I'm going to display the wrong. So, if http.responseText equals y, then I'm going to output the image. Otherwise, I'm going to output the other image. So how do I output an image? Well, we learned that from one of the JavaScript labs, right? We can just make that HTML code. And we can say image equals and make the image tag. Image src equals write.jpg all equals right, or we can say image equals wrong.jpg. So that forms a variable that has the image that we want to display. Now we have to actually display it, and we can say document get element by ID, then what was the ID we called it? Results one. We can set the inner HTML equal to that image. Now we could do this a couple different ways, all right, but this is probably the most straightforward way that we can do it. So let's move our change program and the other images over and test this out. All right. So we have our quiz. We answer correct. or we answer incorrect, and boom, we have a problem. All right? No, it's not smart enough to know that. I'm thinking maybe it's this, because that might be a reserved word in JavaScript. Response. I'm actually doing what you shouldn't do. What am I doing that you shouldn't do? Well, that's a weird question. I'm guessing at what the answer is. All right? I didn't look to see if there was any error messages. So, shame on me. Okay. So that didn't work. And that's a good lesson for me, and that's a good lesson for you. That when you have a problem like this, don't just try things, thinking, well, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Instead, use a systematic approach. And what I can do is look at more tools, developers' tools, and I can look at the console and say, unexpected end of input, line 62, process form 83 is not defined. Okay. Now, it's telling me process form is not defined, which is nonsense. Process form is defined. All right? This is where you have to read between the lines with error messages, because error messages, remember, it's a computer program that's giving you these error messages. It's not a human that has judgment that can look and say, hey, you big dummy, you forgot a bracket, right? If it's telling me that it can't find process form, and I can clearly see process form here, what happened? Yes. Maybe I misspelled the function. That would be one possibility. Maybe, or I got the case wrong. Maybe instead of mixing upper and lower case. But I don't think that's the case. Because this was working a minute ago before I started doing the image things. What I ran into is this. What I ran into is this. If there's an error somewhere in the script tag before here, if it's a bad enough error, that will cause this function to, this will cause the script to blow up before I get to this function. Okay? And therefore, this function never gets loaded. So if I have a big enough problem somewhere between the start of the script and here, alright, the start of the script is here, and obviously something's gone wrong by the time I hit here, because it doesn't recognize that. Yes. I forgot a curly bracket, right. All right. But here's the good news. I've now narrowed it down to half the function or half the script tag, right? Because I know that whatever problem happened, happened before line 49. Because it can't find line 49. If I look at the error in more detail, unexpected end of input, that gives me a second clue. It hit the end here of the script, and it's still expecting something. All right? That's what it means when it says unexpected input. So I forgot to give it something. All right? Now, here's where I'm also going to think to myself, what is the last thing that I changed? This worked 10 minutes ago, all right, when it was doing something else. So probably what I've changed is probably the problem. Well, what did I change? I changed this here. Now we can start looking at this function in more detail and see, well, that matches up with that. What matches up with this? Nothing. So really what I did is, somehow through all this, I didn't have the right number of curly brackets. So that goes with that, that goes with that, and now I should be back in business. Everyone does this. Everyone does the mistake that I made initially, looking at the code and saying, oh, maybe it's this, and trying it. That works very rarely, but everyone still tries it. So learn the lesson. Don't be that guy. Don't be Mike, all right? Be Mike 2. Don't be Mike 1. Mike 1 just was taking shots at things. Mike 2 took a systematic approach. You know, the thing I always say, and I'll say it to myself here, because I'm the one that did that. It's like, you think you know what the problem is. If you were so smart, you wouldn't have that problem in the first place, right? So don't be so sure you know the problem just by glancing at it. Instead, take the time to actually see the error reports that you're getting and see, get a good grip on what the actual symptoms are before you start taking guesses as to what the problem is. All right, so now we should be in good shape. Yay! And there's our happy face if we got it right. Ooh, and there's our frowny face if we got it wrong. All right, what's my point here? My point here is that it's the client that is responsible for formatting the output. All right? It's my client whose job it is to format the output. The server should simply return data. So, I could write this a different way. I could write this so that the server returned the one image if they got it correct and returned the other image if they got it wrong. Well, that wouldn't be horrible. I would suggest that that's not the correct approach. The correct approach is for the server to simply return the data, the results. And if the question, if you're grading a quiz, what are the results? Well, did you get the question right or wrong? So either a Y or an AND, a true or a false, even incorrect or correct was good. But the server shouldn't return like an image that says, well, this is the image we're going to display. Let the client decide that. You get a lot more flexibility in your code if the server simply returns data and then does its thing. Let's imagine, for example, that we had a generic grading program that graded any kind of quiz. We could have the client gear the results differently for different populations of people. Maybe for younger kids it does display the picture. Maybe for older people it displays correct or incorrect. You know, it's more flexible if it simply returns the results and let the client decide what to do with it. Now we could do more than this, right? For example, we could actually change change the style of our question depending on whether they got it right or wrong. So I'm going to put two different styles in here. And again, for simplicity, I'm just going to put the styles as part of the HTML page. You know that the better practice is to have an external style sheet. have a style for if they got it correct. They have a different style if they got it incorrect. So, they got it correct. I can document get element by ID. Question one. Class name equals correct. Yes.
Where you put question one, you put what?
Oh, thank you. And then I can do incorrect here. So if they get it correct, it changes the style of the question. If I get it incorrect, wow, that's pretty brutal, but gets the point across. Why did I do a strike through in addition to red, by the way? Yes. Yeah, in case a person is colorblind. Remember, if you're going to use color for something, use some other technique as well. All right. So in this case, I used green and red to indicate whether it's right or wrong. I also used a strike through in the case of if they're wrong, and I used no text decoration if they were right. As opposed to even it up, I could do something like underline it if they got it correct.
Or bold.
Or bold, yeah. Let's do bold. So if they get it right. It's a little hard to see, but it in fact is bold. Now, why am I doing this other than maybe I just wanted to look at frowny faces and happy faces today? I did this, again, to give a sense of who has responsibility for what. It's the client's responsibility to change the way the page looks to reflect the results. The server only has the responsibility to return your results. Yes, you're wrong. No, you're incorrect. It's the client's job to decide how that is going to be displayed. All right? You can write a lot more flexible code if you return simply the results and let the client make the decision of, hey, this is how I'm going to display the results. So let's think for a second. If we were going to do more than one question on the quiz, all right, let's say I added a second question to the quiz. What should the server return? And I'll give you a couple choices and tell me which you think would be better. And again, we'll just talk about two questions, but the same thing applies to whether it is two questions or 100 questions. I could return either a Y and an N, then a comma, then another Y and an N, depending on whether they got both questions right, both questions wrong, or one right and one wrong. So if they got them both right, I would return Y, comma Y. If they got both wrong, I'd return N, comma N. If they got the first one right, I'd return Y, comma N, and so on. That's option one. Option two would be to return the number of questions that they got right. So if they got both of them right, I'd return two. If they got one of them right, I'd return one. If they got none of them right, I'd return zero. Which do you think is better? Okay, so return the individual right or wrong for the question, all right? Anyone have a different viewpoint? I agree. It would be better to return just the results and which questions they got right and which questions they have wrong. Now, I have a slightly different reason for that, all right? Sometimes, as a teacher, maybe I'd want to tell you, you got 2 out of 5 right. You figure out which ones you got right and which ones you got wrong, and then go and try again. So maybe I'd want to do that. Or maybe sometimes I'd want to tell you, hey, you got questions 1, 2, and 3 right, you got question 4 wrong. If I return the individual answers, I can do both. Right? If I return a Y, let's say I gave 3 questions, if I returned a Y, Y, N, I could have my client, all right, tally up how many Y's there were and say you got 2 right. Or I could have my client display you got question 1 right, you got question 2 wrong, and you got question 3 right. Okay? So, by returning the answers to the individual questions, I let my client code decide how to display the output. And that's a good separation between the client and server. The server's job should be to return the results and let the client decide how it's going to display the results. So, this comes into delimited data. All right? Now, let's go in real quick. Let's make a second question. We should be able to get through this in class today. And again, even if we sort of half rush through it, we'll be able to go back and review this on Monday. So let's add a second question here. Question 2. So let's see, I copy that question over and I change every place where it says 1 to 2. All right. Staring at your code and trying random stuff is the best debugging technique. Notice I said best and not most popular. If I said most popular, the answer would be true, but it's not the best. Now, how am I going to send my answer back to the server? From the server, rather. This is where I'm going to send delimited data. In other words, I'm going to put a comma between my two answers. So I could do that a couple different ways. I'm going to do it this way. So I'm going to put answer 1, a comma, and then answer 2. All right? So if they got both of them right, it would be Y, comma, Y. If they got both of them wrong, it would be N, comma, N. All All right. What I have to do then on the client is I have to take the result string and split it into its individual answers. And there's actually a function to do that. And it is the split method. And what it allows us to do is allows us to take an array or rather take a string and split it into its pieces. So I'm going to say HTTP response text, that's my response. I want to split that and I want to use a comma to split that. So what it is going to do then is it's going to take and create an array. An array is a list of values, all right? And to refer to an array, you have to refer to the element, or refer to an element of the array, you have to give it the number, starting with zero. So, if I split using a Y, REZ 0 is going to be the results of the first question. RES 1 is going to be the result of the second question. So, after I split this, I can then test to see if RES 0 is Y. I can do that. And then I can test to see if RES 1 equals Y. I'm going to do something. Please don't tell anyone in any of my other classes I did this. I'm going to put a break tag in here. Only because we are short on time and I want to finish this example today. I've gone on for hours at a time ranting on why you should never use a break tag. All right, so I say true and false. Oh, something's wrong. It's telling me I have both wrong. I didn't, no. I didn't format my request right. That was not a case of me staring at it until I knew it was wrong. It was a case of me having done this a million times and being able to recognize an error as soon as I made it. Or not as soon as I made it, but shortly after making it. So I have to change my request, right? Because now I'm sending two pieces of data over, where before I was only sending one. And there's still a problem. I'll tell you what, I will go and open the lab. I will work on getting the answer to this, and I will post the corrected version. I'm sure it's something small. So we'll go and do that. All right, let's review the roles of the client and server in the Ajax interaction. Then we're going to look at the example we had last time, and we're going to extend it a bit. The client has the following roles. The client is sort of the driving force with Ajax. Which makes sense, because we're talking about ultimately altering a page that's already been loaded. And that's the job of client-side scripting, because that page is loaded in the browser. So if we want to change that page, the initiative has to come from the client. The server's just out there. After the server delivers a page, the server's just out there sitting waiting for the next request. So that page lives within the browser. So if we want to make any changes to it, like in the case of Google, get the next suggested search terms, or in the case of our example, grade the quiz, the client has to initiate it. So the client is responsible for the following things. Number one, making the object that serves as the pipeline. Typically, this will happen as soon as the page loads. We're going to make that object right away so that we have it available if we need to make that request. And the manner in which it is created is browser dependent. In other words, depending on the kind of browser, the exact instructions to make that vary a little bit. But once you make that object, the rest of it works the same regardless of the browser that you're using. So the client side is responsible for doing this. The client side then, at the appropriate time, based on some user action, and again, in the case of Google, it could be the user pressing a key. In the case of our quiz, it could be us clicking a button to say, go ahead and grade the quiz. But at some point, a user action initiates a JavaScript function. And that JavaScript function uses the pipeline to make a request to the server. The request to the server is what? It's a URL. That's how requests get sent to the server, via URL. So in other words, you type in something in your address bar. That's making a request to the server. What do you type in your address bar? You type into the address bar a URL. You click on a link. You are making a request. What is the request? Well, the URL that the link is for. You press submit on a form, you are making a request. What is the URL? Well, the action of the form is the URL. And you pass the data associated with that form. So the only difference between this and other requests that the client makes is we're actually writing a function to use that pipeline to make the request. So we actually hand code the request ourselves. Now, part of making the request is we define in the pipeline a callback function. And this is the one piece that is a little different than anything we've done before. The idea of a callback function is this. This happens asynchronously. That means not at the same time. So it's more like exchanging voicemails than having a phone conversation. When you have a phone conversation, that is a synchronous conversation, right? Because you're both on the phone at the same time. You say something, the other person responds, and back and forth. If you're exchanging voicemails, all right, you send your message out to them, you don't know when they're going to respond. So you don't sit there waiting for them to send you a voicemail back. Right? You give your number and say, hey, call me at such and such number. When they get around to it, they send the request back and they use that phone number to send the response back to you. Well, the callback function is sort of like your return phone number. It is what is going to get executed when the server is done processing your request. So, when your request is finished, that callback function gets called. And then you can do something with the results. And that's sort of the last thing that the client is responsible for, is doing something with the results from the server. So in the case of Google, as you type in words, it forms a drop-down for you that you can pick the search term. In our case, we put next to the quiz question whether they got it right or wrong. So the client does all of this. The server is responsible for just one thing. Processing the request. Doing whatever it needs to do to handle the request. In our case, it looks at the answer, compares it to the correct answer, and returns either correct or incorrect. And it's going to return the data in one of several different forms. Either, well, there are a couple other options, but for the most part, delimited data, JSON data, or XML data. For the first while, we're going to focus on delimited data, and then we'll get into JSON and XML data later on. But that's all the server does. Takes a request, returns the answer. It's no longer responsible for returning a complete page for this part of the operation. For this part of the operation, it's simply returning the response back. All right, so let's look at the example we had last time and see what's going on. And then we'll enhance it a little bit. We'll enhance it to do a couple different things. copy these guys over to my web servers folder. This question, I can click an answer, click calculate, and without reloading the page, it gives me that response back. All right, so let's look at the code that does that. Most of the code is going to be in quiz.html. It's going to be in the HTML side. So let's find each of the pieces that I have up on the board. The first piece, creating the request object. That exists within the script. And notice that this var HTTP is declared outside of any function. That makes it a global variable. When you define a variable in JavaScript outside of any function, that means that it can be used inside of any function. All right? So that makes it a global variable. So that's why this is not within any function. This will execute as soon as the page loads. So, as soon as the page loads, we have that object available to do whatever we want to with it. Now, remember we said that it's browser dependent. This creates the request object one of two different ways, depending on whether you're on Internet Explorer or not. In either case, it returns the request object, and I store it in a variable called HTTP. So as soon as this page loads, this variable gets set to the results of this create request object, and that create request object creates a request object one of two different ways. All right, so that HTTP variable contains a request object that's waiting out there to handle Ajax requests. All right, the user initiates the Ajax action. In our case, they do that by clicking a button to process the form. Processing the form first validates the form, make sure that they've entered everything in. Now, I haven't completed that. I'm lying, and I'm just saying the form is valid no matter what. But if the form is valid, I go and perform getResults. GetResults is the portion that is going to make the request and give the callback function. So how do we make the request? Well, I format the URL. Remember, we have written, or we are going to write, either both the client side and the server side code. So we know the format that the request needs to be in. And in this case, we know that the format of the request is this. It has to be gradequiz.php answer1 equals, and then either a T or an F. A T if the person checked true, an F if they've checked false. So I'm forming the URL by hard coding this piece of it, because I know that piece is the same no matter what. What's different is the actual value of the answer, whether it's T or an F. And I grab that by looking at which of the radio buttons was selected. So if answer 1 was selected, or rather if true for answer 1 is selected, I set my variable A1 to T. If the false button was selected, I set it to an F. And then I add that as part of the URL. So this is the request that I'm going to make. Now remember, when we make the request, when we send our voicemail, we have to give the number that's our callback number. In other words, where we need to be notified when the request has been completed, when there's a response. And in our case, that is the name of the function that's going to handle the response. And in our case, the name of the function that's going to handle the response is called displayResults. And here we actually make the request. We actually send that data to the server and let the server do its thing. All right. So at this point, we've made the request. And the client, frankly, for the microseconds that it takes for the server to respond, is just sitting there waiting for the response back. Now, the server code that handles this is very straightforward. We simply look at the value of the answer. If it's equal to F, then they got the answer correct, and we echo correct. If it's not F, we echo the value of incorrect. That's all that the server does. The server simply returns one word. In fact, actually, shouldn't even return that HTML. Should just literally return correct or incorrect. Shouldn't even return, because it doesn't need to return those HTML tags, because it's not returning a complete web page. It's just returning the words correct or the words incorrect. So, when the server has sent its response back, the display result function gets called. How do we know it gets called? Because that's the function that we set on our pipeline for on ready state change. Now, it doesn't only get called when the request is done. It gets called at a couple steps throughout the process. The ready state says at what step the server is at. A ready state of 4 means that the server is done. So we are then able to get the value of the results and display those on the page. Now, if we're using delimited data, which we're sort of using here, or we're using JSON, the response is going to come back in a variable in the pipeline called response text. So HTTP response text is where the server puts the result. So in our case, what I do is I get the value of that response text, and then I display it in my results in our HTML. So there's my results. It says whether they got that question correct or incorrect. And I could put that anywhere. So I could put that before the question if I wanted to. And it's going to work the same way. Puts it there. Okay. So, in this case, I'm simply displaying whether they got it correct or incorrect. Alright? I could actually make it simpler and just return a Y or an N if I wanted to. Y indicating they got it correct and N indicating that they got it incorrect. I don't want to display a Y or an N. I want to do something else. Well, that's the client's job. The server simply returns back data. It's the client's responsibility to format that data any way we want to. So, for example, we could display an image. I don't know why I'm looking at this like this is the most important decision I'm going to make today. It's what smiley face to pick. Let's pick this one. Let's pick the thumbs up one. All right. We could display a happy face if they got it right, and then a frowny face if they got it wrong. Oh. That looks harsh. Mm-hmm. That's a little harsh for me, but I'm going to use it anyhow. Yeah, really? Yeah. And then I'm going to edit these real quick to make them smaller, because, I mean, we're not that happy, nor are we that sad. So, let's go here. Let's make that 10%. That's a little too small. Let's make it 20%. Perfect. And I'll change this to say, I'll change the names of them simply to be right and wrong. Okay. So I'm going to copy those in here. And I'm going to change my quiz. Have it open. And I'm going to make this a little more involved. Instead of simply outputting what the server gave me, remember the server gave me a Y or an N, I'm going to test that value. And if that value equals Y, I'm going to display the right. And if it's wrong, I'm going to display the wrong. So, if http://response.txt equals y, then I'm going to output the image. Otherwise, I'm going to output the other image. So how do I output an image? Well, we learned that from one of the JavaScript labs, right? We can just make that HTML code. And we can say image equals and make the image tag. Image src equals write.jpg all equals right. Or we can say image equals wrong.jpg. So that forms a variable that has the image that we want to display. Now we have to actually display it. And we can say document get element by ID. Then what was the ID we called it? Results 1. We can set the inner HTML equal to that image. Now we could do this a couple different ways. All right, but this is probably the most straightforward way that we can do it. So let's move our change program and the other images over and test this out. So we have our quiz. We answer correct or we answer incorrect, and boom, we have a problem. All right.
Is it all right on both images or
no? No. It's not smart enough to know that. Thinking maybe it's this, because that might be a reserved word in JavaScript. Response text equals Y. I'm actually doing what you shouldn't do. What am I doing that you shouldn't do? Well, that's a weird question. I'm guessing at what the answer is. All right? I didn't look to see if there was any error messages. So, shame on me. Okay. So that didn't work. And that's a good lesson for me, and that's a good lesson for you. That when you have a problem like this, don't just try things thinking, well, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Instead, use a systematic approach. And what I can do is look at more tools, developers' tools, and I can look at the console and say unexpected end of input, line 62, process form 83 is not defined. Okay. Now, it's telling me process form is not defined, which is nonsense. Process form is defined. All right? This is where you have to read between the lines with error messages, because error messages, remember, it's a computer program that's giving you these error messages. It's not a human that has judgment that can look and say, hey, you big dummy, you forgot a bracket. Right? If it's telling me that it can't find process form, and I can clearly see process form here, what happened? Yes?
You maybe misspelled the function when you called it.
Maybe I misspelled the function. That would be one possibility. Maybe, or I got the case wrong, maybe instead of mixing upper and lower case. But I don't think that's the case, because this was working a minute ago before I started doing the image things. What I ran into is this. What I ran into is this. If there's an error somewhere in the script tag before here, if it's a bad enough error, that will cause this function to, this will cause the script to blow up before I get to this function. Okay? And therefore, this function never gets loaded. So if I have a big enough problem somewhere between the start of the script and here, all right, the start of the script is here, and obviously something's gone wrong by the time I hit here, because it doesn't recognize that. Yes?
You forgot to put an end.
I forgot a curly bracket, right. All right. But here's the good news. I've now narrowed it down to half the function, or half the script tag, right? Because I know that whatever problem happened before line 49, because it can't find line 49. If I look at the error in more detail, unexpected end of input, that That gives me a second clue. It hit the end here of the script, and it's still expecting something. All right? That's what it means when it says unexpected input. So I forgot to give it something. All right? Now, here's where I'm also going to think to myself, what is the last thing that I changed? This worked 10 minutes ago, all right, when it was doing something else. So probably what I've changed is probably the problem. Well, what did I change? I changed this here. Now we can start looking at this function in more detail and see, well, that matches up with that. What matches up with this? Nothing. So really what I did is somehow through all this, I didn't have the right number of curly brackets. So that goes with that. That goes with that. And now I should be back in business. Everyone does this. Everyone does a mistake that I made initially. Looking at the code and saying, oh, maybe it's this, and trying it. That works very rarely. But everyone still tries it. So, learn the lesson. Don't be that guy. Don't be Mike, all right? Be Mike 2. Don't be Mike 1. Mike 1 just was taking shots at things. Mike 2 took a systematic approach. You know, the thing I always say, and I'll say it to myself here because I'm the one that did that. It's like, you think you know what the problem is. If you were so smart, you wouldn't have that problem in the first place. Right? So don't be so sure you know the problem just by glancing at it. Instead, take the time to actually see the error reports that you're getting and see, get a good grip on what the actual symptoms are before you start taking guesses as to what the problem is. All right, so now we should be in good shape. Yay! And there's our happy face, we got it right. Ooh, and there's our frowny face if we got it wrong. All right. What's my point here? My point here is that it's the client that is responsible for formatting the output. All right? It's my client whose job it is to format the output. The server should simply return data. So, I could write this a different way. I could write this so that the server returned the one image if they got it correct and returned the other image if they got it wrong. Well, that wouldn't be horrible. I would suggest that that's not the correct approach. The correct approach is for the server to simply return the data, the results. And if the question, if you're grading a quiz, what are the results? Well, did you get the question right or wrong? So either a Y or an N, a true or a false, even incorrect or correct was good. But the server shouldn't return like an image that says, well, this is the image we're going to display. Let the client decide that. You get a lot more flexibility in your code if the server simply returns data and then does its thing. Let's imagine, for example, that we had a generic grading program that graded any kind of quiz. We could have the client gear the results differently for different populations of people. Maybe for younger kids it does display the picture. Maybe for older people it displays correct or incorrect. You know, it's more flexible if it simply returns the results and let the client decide what to do with it. Now we could do more than this, right? For example, we could actually change the style our question depending on whether they got it right or wrong. So I'm going to put two different styles in here. And again, for simplicity, I'm just going to put the styles as part of the HTML page. You know that the better practice is to have an external style sheet. So, I have a style for if they got it correct, I have a different style if they got it incorrect. So, if they got it correct, I can document get element by ID. Question one. Class name equals correct. Yes.
Where you put question one, you put book.
Oh, thank you. And then I can do incorrect here. So if they get it correct, it changes the style of the question. If I get it incorrect, wow, that's pretty brutal, but gets the point across. Why did I do a strike through in addition to red, by the way? Yes. Yeah, in case a person is colorblind. Remember, if you're going to use color for something, use some other technique as well. All right. So in this case, I used green and red to indicate whether it's right or wrong. I also used a strike through in the case of if they're wrong, and I used no text decoration if they were right. As opposed to even it up, I could do something like underline it if they got it correct.
Or bold.
Or bold, yeah. Let's do bold. So if they get it right. It's a little hard to see, but it in fact is bold. Now, why am I doing this other than maybe I just wanted to look at frowny faces and happy faces today? I did this, again, to give a sense of who has responsibility for what. It's the client's responsibility to change the way the page looks to reflect the results. The server only has the responsibility to return your results. Yes, you're wrong. No, you're incorrect. It's a client's job to decide how that is going to be displayed. All right? You can write a lot more flexible code if you return simply the results and let the client make the decision of, hey, this is how I'm going to display the results. So let's think for a second if we were going to do more than one question on the quiz. All right? Let's say I added a second question to the quiz. What should the server return? And I'll give you a couple choices and tell me which you think would be better. And again, we'll just talk about two questions, but the same thing applies to whether it is two questions or 100 questions. I could return either a Y and an N, then a comma, then another Y and an N, depending on whether they got both questions right, both questions wrong, or one right and one wrong. So if they got them both right, I would return Y, comma, Y. If they got both wrong, I'd return N, comma, N. If they got the first one right, I'd return Y, comma, N, and so on. That's option one. Option two would be to return the number of questions that they got right. So if they got both of them right, I'd return 2. If they got one of them right, I'd return 1. If they got none of them right, I'd return 0. Which do you think is better?
I lean towards knowing which one is right and which one is wrong. So the separation, the distinction, rather than just a generic number.
Okay. So return the individual right or wrong for the question. All right? Anyone have a different viewpoint? I agree. It would be better to return just the results and which questions they got right and which questions they have wrong. Now, I have a slightly different reason for that. All right? Sometimes, as a teacher, maybe I'd want to tell you, you got 2 out of 5 right. You figure out which ones you got right and which ones you got wrong, and then go and try again. So maybe I'd want to do that. Or maybe sometimes I'd want to tell you, hey, you got questions 1, 2, and 3 right, you got question 4 wrong. If I return the individual answers, I can do both, right? If I return a Y, let's say I gave 3 questions, if I returned a Y, Y, N, I could have my client, all right, tally up how many Y's there were and say you got 2 right. Or I could have my client display you got question 1 right, you got question 2 wrong, and you got question 3 right. Okay? So, by returning the answers to the individual questions, I let my client code decide how to display the output. And that's a good separation between the client and server. The server's job should be to return the results and let the client decide how it's going to display the results. So, this comes into delimited data. All right? Now, let's go in real quick. Let's make a second question. We should be able to get through this in class today. And again, even if we sort of half rush through it, we'll be able to go back and review this on Monday. So let's add a second question here. Question 2. So let's see, I copy that question over and I change every place where it says 1 to 2. All right. Staring at your code and trying random stuff is the best debugging technique. Notice I said best and not most popular. If I said most popular, the answer would be true, but it's not the best. Now, how am I going to send my answer back to the server? From the server, rather. This is where I'm going to send delimited data. In other words, I'm going to put a comma between my two answers. So I could do that a couple different ways. I'm going to do it this way. So I'm going to put answer 1, a comma, and then answer 2. Alright? So if they got both of them right, it would be y, comma, y. If they got both of them wrong, it would be n, comma, n. Alright. What I have to do then on the client is I have to take the result string and split it into its individual answers. And there's actually a function to do that. And it is the split method. And what it allows us to do is allows us to take an array or rather take a string and split it into its pieces. So I'm going to say HTTP response text, that's my response. I want to split that and I want to use a comma to split that. So what it is going to do then is it's going to take and create an array. An array is a list of values, all right? And to refer to an array, you have to refer to the element, or refer to an element of the array, you have to give it the number, starting with 0. So, if I split using a y, rez 0 is going to be the results of the first question. res 1 is going to be the result of the second question. So, after I split this, I can then test to see if RES0 is Y. I can do that. And then I can test to see if RES1 equals Y. I'm going to do something. Please don't tell anyone in any of my other classes I did this. I'm going to put a break tag in here. Only because we are short on time and I want to finish this example today. I've gone on for hours at a time ranting on why you should never use a break tag. All right, so I say true and false. Oh, something's wrong. It's telling me I have both wrong. Format my request right. That was not a case of me staring at it until I knew it was wrong. It was a case of me having done this a million times and being able to recognize an error as soon as I made it. Or not as soon as I made it, but shortly after making it. So I have to change my request, right? Because now I'm sending two pieces of data over, where before I was only sending one. And there's still a problem. I'll tell you what, I will go and open the lab. I will work on getting the answer to this, and I will post the corrected version. I'm sure it's something small. So we'll go and do that. All right.